the few bright spots in Joe Biden's administration has in fact been his National Labor Relations Board, the NLRB, which has fought hard to protect workers' rights, especially at a time when more and more companies have workers attempting to organize their workplace and join unions. But even still, the NLRB unfortunately has massive limitations, which would only get worse under a Republican administration. Now, perhaps the biggest of those limitations is the board's inability to force companies to bargain with newly unionized workers. As the New Republic reports, the first Starbucks store unionized in December of 2021 in Buffalo, New York, the first REI store in March of 2022 in Manhattan, the first Amazon warehouse in April of 2022 on Staten Island, the first Apple store in June of 2022 in Towson, Maryland. Yet workers from all four companies, much like Trader Joe's workers, say a first contract remains miles away. And the problem goes far beyond those four companies, and it's because their employers are just refusing to engage in good faith contract negotiations with the newly unionized workers. According to a recent survey by Bloomberg Law, between the years of 2005 and 2007, it took American unions an average of 364 days to negotiate a first contract. By the year of 2022, though, that average actually climbed to more than 565 days. So the situation clearly getting worse. According to John Logan, who's the chair of labor studies of the labor studies department at San Francisco State University, that same process takes just 3 to 4 months in many other advanced industrialized countries. So let's just pause to discuss that real quick, John. What are your thoughts on how insanely difficult it is to get employers to engage in negotiations?
Yeah. Well, first I would say on the, you know, it only taking 3 to 4 months in other advanced societies. I think that once we identify enough areas where we are exponentially worse than these others, I think we should say it takes that long in advanced societies. In our society, which is not yet advanced, except perhaps in how much power we've given to corporations, it takes significantly longer. So you were right to point out how much longer it takes than it used to. I imagine it's tougher to come to a deal because corporations are doing so much worse than they used to.
Right.
So it matters to them more. No, it's ridiculous. And also the initial setup of the unions and those corporations that you pointed out, like there are people who work many years at those places, but there's also a lot of turnover. Mm-hmm. And so there are a ton of people who have gone to work at these places, been excited about unionization, and then inevitably moved on after a year or two. And I wonder to what extent that's part of the corporate strategy.
Oh.
That it becomes a little bit harder to sustain a movement like that when you have a relatively higher degree of flux in your employees.
100%. It's definitely part of the corporate strategy. And look, stalling also has the added possible benefit of just waiting to see if there's going to be a less friendly National Labor Relations Board following the election, right? And so that is something that I'm definitely concerned about here. So just something to consider as the election cycle continues to heat up. Now let's do a deeper dive on these contract negotiations. So why do companies drag out the negotiations for so long, John? Let's actually address it here. One reason is that companies want to grind out the fledgling unions into accepting bad contracts, right? So if you've been engaging in this for a super long time, and you're getting real tired of it, you might just settle for a contract that you're not really crazy about. And I think employers are using that tactic. There are also other issues at play. So these companies have way more resources at their disposal, I should say. Just take a look at how much anti-union consultants are getting paid. I mean, instead of like improving working conditions and pay for their workers, they'll shell out millions of dollars to these anti-union consultants, which is infuriating. Furthermore, companies want to make an example of these organized locations or unionized locations to dissuade employees from other stores from trying to unionize, so that there's that issue as well. And once a full year elapses after workers first vote to unionize, workers can petition to decertify or vote out the union.
Yeah.
So they're hoping for that as well.
Yeah, also I apologize if you sort of implied this. I don't think we specifically emphasized it, but just in case it's not clear, and it probably should be clear, you also don't have to pay whatever the extra money or benefits would be for as long as you delay. It's just like that is just raw money that you're making right there. Mm-hmm. And honestly, it's not like you couldn't have some sort of regulation wherein once a deal is finally reached, what you have to then back pay for the time that it took to reach that, or some percentage of it, which would incentivize coming to a deal relatively quicker. The government could put pressure on corporations or something like that through the NLRB, but obviously they're not gonna do something like that anytime soon.
Well, here's the problem. So there are, again, limitations to what the NLRB can do, right? So I'll give you specific examples. There's Kate Bronfenbrenner, who is the Director of Labor Education Research at Cornell University, and here's what she says. There's essentially nothing under labor law that forces employers to bargain, and the penalties are usually just a posting on the bulletin board. For employers, that is less than a slap on the wrist. I mean, yeah, 100%, that's so true. It is less than a slap on the wrist. And by the way, some states are friendlier to labor than others. So in California, even though I have tons of complaints about leadership in California, we do actually have more robust laws protecting labor compared to other states. So-called right to work states, which on its face sound like it's a good thing. But no, right to work states basically allow employers to fire anyone for any reason and not even really provide a reason for it. And there are less protections for workers in states like that. Now, there are some possible solutions though. So the one way out, according to Jennifer Abruzzo, who's on the National Labor Relations Board, board's general counsel, says that the NLRB, she argues, should overturn the 1970 XLO decision, in which the labor board ruled that it can't impose financial penalties on employers that refuse to bargain in good faith. Abruzzo wants the board to adopt a new rule holding that when companies don't bargain in good faith, they can be required to make employees whole with monetary relief for the lost opportunity to make gains through the collective bargaining process. Such monetary relief could mean, for instance, paying out money that workers would have received as raises to keep up with the past 2 years of inflation. Now, the bad news is that if Joe Biden doesn't get reelected, or if we don't have a Democratic administration in place following the 2024 presidential elections, and we instead have a Republican like Nikki Haley or Donald Trump leading the country in the executive branch, the NLRB is certainly going to be weaker, not stronger. And the likelihood of passing a measure that was just noted by Jennifer Abruzzo is unlikely. So look, let's take a look at the other side real quick, like Nikki Haley, who can't help herself from bragging about how much she hates labor. Take a look.
When you have the most pro-union president and he touts that he is emboldening the unions, this is what you get. And I'll tell you who pays for it is the taxpayers. South Carolina is governor. I mean, we were building planes with Boeing. We were building more BMWs than any place in the world. I recruited Mercedes-Benz. I recruited Volvo. We had 5 international tire companies. But I was a union buster. I didn't want to bring in companies that were unionized simply because I didn't want to have that change the environment in our state.
I was just so proud. I'm a union buster. I hate labor. I will bust those unions.
I love every part of what she said. She's like, dear potential voters, I made our state so appealing to corporations from how I crushed all of you into the ground that they were desperate to come and use what was left of all of you. Wouldn't you like to put me in charge of the entire country? Except she's surging. That sort of language doesn't hurt. They can be that was explicit. But what about when Trump said wages are too high in multiple debates?
I love that you brought Trump up, because unlike Nikki Haley, Trump in most cases is, I don't know if you want to use the word smart, but he's savvy enough to use populist rhetoric to make it appear as though he gives a damn about American workers. But his actions do prove otherwise. Here's what I mean.
In a new USA Today expose that found hundreds of former employees and contractors have accused Donald Trump and his businesses of failing to pay them for their work.
In 2008, during the Great Recession, he blamed UAW members. He blamed our contracts for everything that was wrong with these companies. That's a complete lie. In 2015, when he was running for president, he talked about doing a rotation, taking all these good paying jobs in the Midwest and moving them somewhere in the South.
He appointed Eugene Scalia, one of the nation's top anti-union lawyers, to be his Secretary of Labor.
Under Trump's administration, the National Labor Relations Board implemented sweeping new rules that made it harder for workers to form unions. Trump packed the courts with anti-labor judges, people like Thomas Farr. President Trump made it harder for workers to earn overtime, and he gutted the federal agency in charge of workplace safety.
Donald Trump is a bad guy, and he runs around with a bunch of bad dudes, okay? Like, he is not friendly to labor. And look, my view on this is, it is unfair to workers to not have a seat at the table, to have a say over their working conditions and their pay. Doesn't mean that they're gonna get everything that they want, but it again means that they have a seat at the table. And remember, these are individuals who help generate the revenue for these incredibly profitable companies that are refusing to share in the wealth. And so again, I'm worried about what this means for the NLRB. Things aren't looking good for the Biden campaign. He's doing poorly in the polls, and that's devastating for a number of reasons, but it's particularly devastating when you consider some of the bright spots in his administration, particularly the NLRB and also the Federal Trade Commission under the leadership of Lina Khan.
Yeah, I'm glad that you're pointing this out. It's one of the stakes in the election, even, you know, apathetic status quo versus literally like them just putting like a pit bull in charge of the NLRB and just having it attack workers as they come through the door. Those are the stakes. This is one of the areas of American politics that make the least sense to me, considering like they say that they're populist. They say that they're for the silent majority against the elites. We hate corporations, which means Disney. They hate Disney and that's it. They like all the rest of them. Even with taxes, we know it's one of the things they care the most about. They pretend that their position on taxes is better for regular people. It's insulting, it makes no sense, but they pretend. In this, they don't pretend. They just say, yeah, we're gonna crush these workers. And workers at home on their couch watching Fox News are like, yeah, screw us.
Well, Fox News isn't covering that. I mean, Fox News isn't, first of all, if they do cover these
types of stories. They demonize unions. They demonize unionization constantly.
That's true, but remember, their audience does not consist of workers. Their audience consists of mostly elderly people who are no longer in the workforce and think that unionization means that they're gonna end up paying a lot more for their products. But, you know, young people, it's such a difficult situation because young people are not happy with the Biden campaign. They're not happy with the Biden administration, but they're also fired up on workers' rights and labor issues as they should be because there's a lot on the line for them. They are workers themselves.
Yeah.
It's just, I'm giving you the details of all the possibilities, what we're dealing with in this election and what the outcome of the election is likely going to mean for workers at a time when, again, the only bright spot I see in our country is a newfound appreciation for organizing the workplace. That's all I can say.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.